Our next speaker, Professor Hatem Amin Attalah, is the professor and the ex-chairman of the Department of Anesthesia and the Critical Care Unit in Munifia University. And he's working as a consultant of anesthesia and intensive care in Alexandria Medical Center. He will share his experience on electrolyte disorders. Can you start, please, Prof. Hatem?
Thanks, Dr. Tahan. At first, I would like to thank Dr. Saad Mahdi and the organizing committee for giving me the opportunity to share in these mega online courses. My lecture today about electrolyte disturbance. Sorry. Is it working?
Yes, that's fine.
Yes. My lecture today about electrolyte disturbance. In the upcoming 30 minutes, we will discuss the sodium and calcium imbalance. And on next Thursday, inshallah, we will discuss potassium, magnesium, and phosphorus imbalance. Starting with the sodium, the importance of sodium is the main component of the equation in measurement of the plasma osmolarity. As we see, plasma osmolarity equal 2 multiplied by sodium plus glucose over 18 plus blood urea nitrogen over 2.8. So any changes in sodium, either increased or decreased, will affect the plasma osmolarity. Also, sodium will affect the blood tonicity. So the net movement of water into or outside the cell is controlled by sodium, resulting in either cell shrinkage or cellular edema. The normal plasma sodium is 135 to 145 milliequivalent per liter. Hyponatremia, it means plasma sodium below 135 milliequivalent per liter. The types of hyponatremia, either hypoosmolar hyponatremia, which is true hyponatremia, when sodium level below, so the osmolality will be lowered also. Under certain condition, hyponatremia may be associated with normal plasma osmolality or even with elevated plasma osmolality. And these two conditions are called pseudo-hyponatremia or false hyponatremia. Starting with the hypoosmolar hyponatremia. The types, according to the volume status of the patient, it can be classified either hypovolemic, euvolemic, or hypervolemic. Hypovolemic hyponatremia, it means there is a losses of water and sodium, either through the kidney by the effect of diuretics, mineralocorticoid deficiency, salt wasting nephropathy, where there is losses of sodium and potassium and other salts, osmotic diuresis, and renal tubular acidosis, or losses through the gastrointestinal tract in case of vomiting, diarrhea, and gastrointestinal fistula, or through the skin in sweating and burns. In euvolemic hyponatremia, in cases of primary or psychogenic polydipsia, syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone, where inappropriate release of the antidiuretic hormone results in a lot of water retention, volume overload, which stimulate the heart receptor to release ANP and BNP and decrease the renin-angiotensin system, decrease aldosterone secretion, so sodium not reabsorbed by the kidney and natriuresis or increased sodium losses in the urine. Also, arginine vasopressin release due to pain and nausea, glucocorticoid deficiency, adrenal insufficiency, or hypothyroidism. Usually the mechanism by bradycardia and the decrease in the cardiac output will increase the antidiuretic hormone and increase the renin-angiotensin system. Also chronic renal insufficiency where urinary sodium is increased. In case of hypervolemic, where assessment of the patient is congested, neck veins, crackles on the lung, maybe pleural effusion, pericardial effusion, edema lower limb. In cases of congestive heart failure, liver cirrhosis, nephrotic syndrome, where it is called dilutional hyponatremia. Pseudohyponatremia or false hyponatremia may occur with normal plasma osmolarity, as in case of marked hyperlipidemia, marked hyperproteinemia, and in TURP syndrome after irrigation by a large volume of glycine causing dilutional hyponatremia. Also hyponatremia with elevated plasma osmolarity in case of uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, hyperglycemia, which produces increased osmotic effect. Also, mannitol dehydration by mannitol will cause drain water into the intravascular volume. The clinical feature, usually we have an increased intracellular volume and cellular edema. So think about the brain. The brain or the neurological manifestation is the mainstay in hyponatremia. So either the patient asymptomatic or starting with nausea, vomiting, depressed level of consciousness, confusion, agitation, stuporized, seizures, and coma. Cerebral edema occurs if sodium level below 120 milli equivalent per liter, and cardiac symptoms may occur if the sodium level below 100 milli equivalent per liter. To reach the diagnosis, by history and physical examination, history if there is losses through vomiting, diarrhea, fistula, or history of renal failure, history of endocrinal disease, also physical examination to assess the volume status of the patient, and three tests should be done. First, plasma osmolality. It is very important to differentiate true hyponatremia from false hyponatremia, where the plasma osmolality is normal or increased. Also urinary osmolality and urinary sodium excretion. As we see here in this scheme, in hypoosmolar hyponatremia, where the plasma osmolarity is low, first we assess the renal condition or the renal status. If it is impaired, so it will be a primary renal disease. If it is normal, we have to assess the volume status of the patient, either volume overload in congestive heart failure, nephrotic syndrome, or liver cirrhosis, or the patient is aovolemic, normovolemic. Think about endocrinal condition, adrenal and thyroid insufficiency. If they are normal, we can do a test. Test for the ability to dilute urine in response to water load. If the patient can able to dilute urine, so it will be a psychogenic polydipsy. If no, consider syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone. In cases of hypovolemia or volume depletion, we will assess urinary sodium excretion. If it is low, below than 10 milli equivalent per liter, consider the cause of losses, diarrhea, and vomiting. If it is high, above 20 milli equivalent per liter, consider salt wasting, nephropathy, or diuretics. The treatment, the goals of the therapy is to raise the plasma sodium concentration by restricting water intake and promote water loss, also to correct underlying disorder. We can use in hypovolemic hyponatremia either normal saline 0.9% or hypertonic saline as 3% concentration. In eovolemic and hypervolemic patient, water restriction only may correct hyponatremia. When to treat when the patient is symptomatic or plasma sodium below 120 milli equivalent per liter. Also, the rule in correction is slow and gradual correction. Avoid rapid correction as it will result in permanent neurological dysfunction. So the correction should not exceed 0.5 to 1 milli equivalent per liter per hour, or maximum 24 hours should not exceed 10 to 12 milli equivalent per liter, either using normal saline or hypertonic saline in severe symptomatic hyponatremia. To calculate the sodium deficit, we have an equation. As we know, the sodium is mainly intravascular and the intracellular compartment is only 10 milli equivalent. So we have a definite equation to correct the intravascular deficit. which is equal to total body water multiplied by desired sodium minus the present sodium. So the total body water equal to the body weight multiplied by 0.6 if the patient is male and 0.5 if the patient is female. Here, to calculate the change in plasma sodium or the rate of infusion by using the infusate sodium, if we use hypertonic saline 3%, it contains 513 milliequivalent per liter minus serum sodium over total body water plus 1. Here an example how to correct hyponatremia. If we have a patient, 45 years, male, 50 kilogram body weight, presented with altered sensorium and agitation. A diagnosis of hypoosmolar hyponatremia is made. Plasma sodium is 110 milliequivalent per liter. So by using the equation, sodium requirement equals desired sodium, if we need to correct it to 130, minus serum sodium, which is the present sodium, 110 multiplied by 50 kilogram times 0.6, because this patient is a male, which the total body water equals 600 milliequivalent. This means that this patient needs 600 milliequivalent sodium to correct the deficit or to elevate it from 110 to 130. So how to give this saline solution and by which rate? By using this equation, the infusate sodium minus serum sodium over total body water plus 1. Here's if we use hypertonic saline 3% minus the present sodium 110 over 30 plus 1 equal 503 over 31 equals 13 milliequivalent per liter. This means every 100 milli of hypertonic saline 3% contains 1.3 milliequivalent per liter. So to correct or to give the 600 milli equivalent, we can use 800 milli of hypertonic saline over 24 hours. So we can ask the nurse to start infusion of hypertonic saline by a rate 34 milli per hour to give a slow and gradual correction, as rapid correction can lead to permanent damage, osmotic demyelination syndrome, or central pontine myelinolysis, which is flaccid paralysis, dysarthria, dysphagia, and it is, has no specific treatment. Anesthetic implications, we have to correct the plasma sodium preoperatively. Should be exceeds and reach at least 130 milliequivalent per liter by calculation the deficit and give the saline or hypertonic saline in a slow, gradual manner before any elective surgery, because lower level during surgery will result in cerebral edema. So we have to expect a decrease in the MAC and postoperative agitation and confusion and delayed recovery. Hypernatremia. Hypernatremia means plasma sodium greater than 145 milliequivalent per liter. The causes here, there is a contracted volume or water deficit. So there is an impaired thirst in case of coma, essential hypernatremia, solute diuresis in case of diabetic ketoacidosis, and hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma. Also, excessive water losses in diabetes insipidus, either central or nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, and in excessive sweating. The types here also hypernatremia with low body sodium content or what is called hypovolemic hypernatremia. Or hypernatremia with normal body sodium content, it is hypernatremia, euvolemic hypernatremia, or hypernatremia and increased body sodium content, hypervolemic hypernatremia. Starting with hypernatremia with low body sodium content, where there is water loss in excess of the sodium loss. So it's called hypovolemic hypernatremia. There is by the effect of osmotic and loop diuretics, diarrhea, vomiting, sweating, and burns. Euvolemic hypernatremia in case of diabetes insipidus, where whether central diabetes insipidus or nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, where there is a loss of large volume of urine, may reach 16 to 20 liters per day. Hypernatremia and increased total body sodium content in case of hypervolemic hypernatremia. This is usually iatrogenic or due to administration of large quantities of hypertonic solution as hypertonic saline, sodium bicarbonate, or total parenteral nutrition. So the clinical features, also think about the brain as there is contracted intracellular volume and cell shrinkage. So there is mainly neurological manifestation as altered mental status, irritability, weakness, focal neurological deficit, coma, and death. Also, this patient prone for intracerebral and subarachnoid hemorrhage. The diagnosis also using by assessing the volume status of the patient. If the extracellular volume is increased, so hypervolemic, hypernatremia due to hypertonic saline or sodium bicarbonate. If the extracellular volume is not increased, we will assess the minimal volume of maximum concentrated urine. If there is minimal volume and concentrated urine, so the cause may be insensible water loss or gastrointestinal loss. If no, and we have a large volume of urine, we can assess the urine osmolality or the excretion rate of urine osmol. If it is high, greater than 750 milliosmol per day, so the cause will be diuretic or osmotic diuresis. If not higher than 750 milliosmol per day, we consider the cause is diabetes insipidus. So we can show the response or the renal response to desmoprosin. We can give a synthetic analog of antidiuretic hormone desmoprosin and detect the urine osmolarity. If it is increased, it will be central diabetes insipidus. If it is unchanged, it will be nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. The treatment. The goals of therapy also to correct water deficits and to stop ongoing water loss. Also, the correction should be gradual and slow over 48 to 72 hours. Using hypotonic solution like dextrose 5%, half strength saline, or even tap water can be given through the nasogastric tube in comatose patient. And the plasma sodium should be lowered by 0.5 milliequivalent per liter per hour and does not exceed 12 milliequivalent per liter in the 24 hours. Here to calculate the water deficit, we have an equation also where water deficit equals plasma sodium minus 40, say 160 or 170, minus 40 over 140, multiplied by the total body water, which is body weight multiplied by 0.6 in case of male and 0.5 in case of female. Also, rapid correction should be avoided because it results in seizure and permanent neurological damage. Anesthetic implications in hypernatremia, where there is increased MAC, and consider enhanced uptake of the inhalation anesthetic causing myocardial depression and the decreased cardiac output. Also, this patient predisposed to hypotension and hypoperfusion. Also, the contracted volume or the decreased volume of distribution, so the dose of intravenous anesthetic agent should be reduced. Disorder of calcium balance. We all know that calcium level in the blood regulated by two hormones, the parathormone secreted from the parathyroid gland and calcitriol or the active vitamin D secreted from the kidney. Here, the normal calcium metabolism after ingestion of calcium in food, it will go to the GIT where it can be absorbed, going to the intravascular compartment where 99% of calcium will be deposited in bone and only 1% present in the intravascular compartment. And here the role of the kidney to filter out calcium, avoiding losses to maintain normal calcium level. So there is a continuing exchange of calcium between blood and the bone tissues. The amount of calcium blood controlled, as we said, by the parathormone and the calcitriol. And these two hormones are in feed negative back mechanism. When the parathormone is decreased, the calcitriol will be increased and vice versa. So in order to maintain the calcium level normal. So the normal plasma calcium ranges from 8.5 to 10.5 milligram per deciliter, 50% of this value in the ionized form or the active form, and 40% will be protein bound. So calcium level must be corrected to albumin changes. For example, in case of hypoalbuminemia, in cases of malnutrition, liver cirrhosis, or nephrotic syndrome, the protein bounding part of the calcium will be reduced, but the ionized calcium remain normal. But in cases of alkalemia, where increase in the pH, there will be the ionized part of the calcium will be lowered, so it should be corrected. Hypocalcemia means plasma calcium level below 8.5 milligram per deciliter. The causes: hypoparathyroidism, either postoperative after surgical removal of the parathyroid gland, or due to autoimmune disease, congenital disease, or due to magnesium deficiency. Also, vitamin deficiency in case of nutritional or malabsorption syndrome, hyperphosphatemia, precipitation of calcium in pancreatitis or rhabdomyolysis, also chelation of calcium after rapid blood transfusion or rapid infusion of large amount of albumin. Here the clinical picture of hypocalcemia is tetany or paresthesia in the circumoral region and the extremities. Also laryngospasm and bronchospasm may occur, abdominal cramps, increased urinary frequency, hypotension and arrhythmia may occur. Also latent hypocalcemia, which can be manifested by Shavostic sign or Trousseau sign. Shavostic sign by tapping on the facial nerve in front of the external auditory meatus will cause ipsilateral facial muscle contraction. This is due to hyperexcitability of the facial nerve. Also Trousseau sign, where inducing ischemia by elevation of the cuff of the blood pressure for more than 3 minutes will induce carpopedal spasm. The pseudomonic features in ECG in hypocalcemia is the prolongation of QT interval. The treatment in severe or emergency condition after surgical removal, postoperative surgical removal of the parathyroid gland, we should give calcium, or in presence of tetany, of course, or symptomatic conditions, we can give calcium gluconate intravenous over 10 minutes and serial calcium measurement, so the dose may be repeated, and also correction of coexisting alkalosis and calcium supplementation in long term should be given. The anesthetic applications in cases of hypocalcemia should be corrected, as we said, preoperative by intravenous route and serial ionized calcium level monitored. Expect the potentiation of the negative inotropic effect of intravenous anesthetic and volatile agents. Also, laryngospasm may be expected during recovery, and alkalosis should be avoided by avoid hyperventilation. Hypercalcemia means increase the plasma calcium above 10.5 milligram per deciliter. The causes here: hyperparathyroidism, either primary or secondary, or in case of malignancy, lung, breast, and cancer, and blood cancers associated with increased calcium level. Paget disease of the bone, excessive vitamin D intake, granulomatous disorder, STB and sarcoidosis, also associated with increased calcium level, milk alkali syndrome, high calcium carbonate intake, resulting in high blood calcium and metabolic alkalosis. Also drugs as thiazide and lithium. The clinical features, starting with anorexia, nausea, vomiting, weakness, then polyuria, ataxia, irritability, lethargy, confusion, and coma. The ECG changes here will be a short QT interval, also prolonged PR interval and wide QRS complex as seen in this ECG. The complication is osteoporosis or bone rarefaction and liable to fracture because of increased calcium in the blood with decreased deposition of calcium in the bone. Also, the increased deposition of calcium in the kidney result in kidney stones, then kidney failure, CNS problem as confusion, dementia, and coma, also arrhythmia may occur. The treatment, first hydration, good hydration with normal saline. Then give loop diuretics like furosemide to maintain urine output more than 3 liters per day. Also correct the associated potassium and magnesium abnormality. And in severe cases, we give bisphosphonate as pamidronate, 60 to 80 milligram IV over 4 hours, calcitonin 2 to 8 units subcutaneous, and in resistant cases, hemodialysis. The anesthetic implication, also correction of hypercalcemia before the operation by saline, good hydration, then diuretics, correction of the associated potassium and magnesium disorders. Also consider decrease the dose of neuromuscular blockers, central venous pressure and pulmonary pressure monitoring, hyperventilation also should be avoided. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Hatem, for this interesting and very informative talk about electrolyte imbalance. And I think it is coming in due time because of the recently published article yesterday in JAMA about hyperkalemia in COVID patients.